word for you today. I believe God has a good word for you today. I'm so glad you guys are here. I know it's the summertime. I know people are traveling, people are having a great time, and I'm all for that. God created the institution of family for a reason, and He wants us to enjoy our family. But I believe that God wants to share something good with you today. And He has a word for you today. I'm going to start off by saying this. Pastor is not a very risky person, I guess I would say it like that. I take calculated risk. I am a risk assessor. I assess the risk and I determine the cost and I determine whether I'm willing to pay that cost. My wife, on the other hand, my wife is a daredevil. Y'all might look at Christy and think she's not, but Christy will try anything. Now, when I was younger, I was a little bit more risky. But as I've gotten older, I'm just a little bit more calculated in what I do. Not too long ago, we were on vacation and we were in San Francisco. And my wife had heard, yeah, she's laughing already. My wife had heard about these walking trails on the backside of a mountain in San Francisco. And my wife is into all of that. She wants to walk trails and she wants to do all those great things, all that fun stuff. And she wants to be in the woods and she wants to do all of that stuff. And so she said, "Hey, we're here. We may never come back again. Can we try this?" Now me, I'm calculating risk. So I said, "Okay, cool, we may not come back, so let's go." So we get to the area where you park, and you park, and once you get out, before you go onto the trails, there's this big sign, and on this big sign, it's like an information board, and on this information board, it tells you that there's three trails. Each trail is anywhere from 3 to 5 miles long. I can already tell you, I'm not looking forward to this. So we get to the information board. Now, the information board, the city of San Francisco is nice enough to tell you what has been seen on these trails within the last 24 to 48 hours. They are nice enough to inform you of what you just might run into. So we get there. Well, Christy is just trying to bypass the board. I said, no. That's information. I need to know what's been seen on these trails for the last 24 to 48 hours. So I'm reading. Trail A, within the last 24 to 48 hours, there was a mountain lion that was seen. Well, I'm going to tell you, I don't want to go on that trail. On trail B, there was a bobcat scene. Well, you asked me, no, I don't want to go on that trail either. On trail C, there was a coyote. And I know coyotes don't come just one at a time. They come in a pack. So you might have seen one, but there were some others hiding around there somewhere. And I'm going, Christian, did you read this? I said, I'm not going on these trails. She said, oh, ain't nothing. That was 2 days ago. They not there no more. She said, come on, let's go. We may never come back again. I said, Christian, what's going on? I said, do you have a special skill set that you haven't shared with me yet that if a bobcat jumps out, you're going to be able to take care of it? I mean, you got a spear or something in your purse that you're going to pull out? You got a gun that I don't know about that you're going to take this thing out? She said, no, but that was 2 days ago. It's gone. I said, how do you know? I said, what's going to happen if we get out there for 3 miles in the middle of the woods? Can't nobody hear you scream? And if you scream, you're just going to draw more attention, more wild animals to you. I said, I don't want to go out there. She said, come on, this might be our only chance. I said, Lord, have mercy. So I said, we're going to go on the shortest trail. And so we start walking. But let me tell you what happens as we begin walking. Oh, Miss All the Courage in the World over here. As we're walking, she's walking behind me holding my arm. All of a sudden, when we get out the car, everybody's kind of spread out doing their own thing. When we pick a trail and we start going down the trail, all of a sudden, everybody is behind me. I said, oh, no, I done seen this movie before. I said, no, 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 no. I said, if we go walk down this trail and something happened, everybody I know is going to say, now, he ain't no good and well. He ain't have no business on that trail. You know black people don't do that. Black people don't go in the woods. But my wife says, come on, let's go, as she stands behind me. So we start off on this trail. We go about 20 paces. And let me tell you something. I am scared out of my mind. I am looking to the left, to the right, in front of me. I'm looking in that corner, I'm looking behind, I'm looking everywhere. And we start walking and we get about 20 paces. And right there to the right-hand side, there is this bush over here on the side of the trail. And all of a sudden, this bush starts shaking like that. That's all I had to see. No, that wasn't the wind. The wind wasn't blowing that hard. I've seen the wind blow a bush. It doesn't move like that. This bush was moving like something was behind it. I said, oh, no, I'm leaving. I said, if you want to go on this trail, you're free to go. But I'm going back to the car. And I turned my little self around, and I went to the car. And everybody followed me. I said, no, pull out your spear. Go on and go on the trail. But I turned around, and I went back to the car. We get back into town. We get back home, maybe. I think that was on a Friday. We get back home on a Sunday evening. And me and Christy are getting up on Monday morning, getting ready for work. And we're watching Good Morning America. And on Good Morning America, the announcement says, in the walking trails of San Francisco, A bobcat attacks a little boy. And they have it on video. And they show the bobcat coming from behind the bush, attacking the little boy walked ahead of his family. And the bobcat comes out of the bush, grabs the little boy by his head, and pulls him off into the weeds. I said, Lord have mercy. I said, see, I told you it was a bobcat out there. I told you that was what was gonna happen. And she didn't say nothing. I said, I am never going on no trails anywhere with you. I will say the family made enough noise for the little boy that the bobcat released the hold on him and the bobcat took off running. So the little boy was safe. But I know that bobcat was behind that bush when he saw me. He got excited. He said, ooh, that's a big one right there. We're gonna be able to eat on him for a minute. He got so excited he couldn't hold himself and he gave it away and the bush started shaking. I said, no, you're not about to get me. And my wife says, you would have been fine. Yeah, because you would have pushed me out and you would have took off running. The title to the message today is simply this: don't run. Now, if you see a bobcat, run. I ain't talking about, I want you to use the wisdom that God has given you. Don't you leave here and go on no trail and say, Pastor said, don't run. No. What I'm saying to you is simply this. See, in life, we are all going to face fearful situations. In life, we're all going to be, I don't care who you are. I don't care what job you have. I don't care how much money you have. I don't care how popular you are. I don't care where you fall in the socioeconomic scale. I don't care what your title is. I don't care what color you are. I don't care how young you are. I don't care how seasoned you are. I don't care. We are all going to face fearful situations. But I'm telling you today, don't run. I'm telling you today, don't run. We've got a lot of track stars in the body of Christ that when life happens, we take our ball and we go home. See, but God is looking for some warriors. Ooh, nobody like that. See, God is looking for some warriors. God is looking for some people that when the going gets tough, the tough get going. God is looking for some. See, because I got news for you. Life is not going to get any easier. Life is not going to get any easier, and it's going to get tougher. And God is looking for some warriors for such a time as this. How many of you know you were created for such a time as this? That's why you're here. That's why you're breathing, because you were created for such a time as this. Everybody in the balcony, you were created for such a time as this. If you're watching me on live stream today, you were created for such a time as this. If you're driving in your car and you're listening, you were created for such a time as this. If you're breathing, you're supposed to be here. If you're breathing, you have a purpose. And it's not to run. See, I need everybody to take off the spikes, take off your running shoes, and I need you to put yourself in a position to war. Ooh. He got quiet. See, God wanted you to say yes because he knows what's coming. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm a warrior. Woo, That was only five of you that said that. See, I know you might not feel like a warrior. I know you might not sense that you're a warrior, but I need you to turn to your neighbor and say it with some oomph behind it and say, I'm a warrior. Yeah, baby. I'm a warrior. See, tell somebody, God created me to fight. God created me to fight. See, some of you before Jesus, you believe that. You look at me wrong, and I'm finna punch you in your mouth. Don't walk by me and graze my shoulder. It's on at you. You touched me. You gave me a reason to want. I've been wanting to punch somebody for the longest anyway. Ain't that right, Jimmy? All you got to do is give me a reason to want to fight. You graze me. You look at me crazy. You look at my wife. You look at my kids. You. If you smell wrong, I want to fight you. But then we got saved, and all of a sudden, we became sissies. See, you say you're not a sissy in the physical. Yeah, you still ready to fight somebody in the physical, but that's not the fight you in anymore. You might be ready to fight somebody in the physical. See, but when you fight in the physical, that's the cowardly way. Uh-oh. See, it takes a warrior to be ready to fight in the spiritual. See, it's easy for me to go punch somebody in the face. It's hard for me to fight the principalities and the rulers of darkness and the spiritual power in high places. See, that takes a warrior. That takes somebody who's put themselves in a position to fight. See, that means I never take my gloves off. That means I'm ready to fight at all times. Some of y'all were like that before Jesus. You was always ready for a fight. If somebody wanted to fight, they called you. See, now I need that attitude to transfer over into the spiritual realm. See, when I'm going into a fight with the enemy, see, I need to be able to come call you. I need to be able to call you and to know that you can fight with me with what I'm facing. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't run. Don't run. Say it again, don't run. We all are going to face fearful situations. See, if you are on this earth for any length of time, you're going to face something that scares you. I don't care who you are. You're going to face something. See, I'm not talking to the people who hadn't been through anything. I'm talking to the people who've been through something. See, I'm talking to the people that have been through something and that had to face something in their life that totally knocked the wind out of them. See, I'm talking to somebody that that went through something that you wasn't expecting it to happen. You didn't know it was coming. It changed your life. You lost somebody. I'm talking to somebody that has been through something and that has seen some things in life, and they have scared you. And it made you want to throw in the towel and run. So today we're going to talk about King David for a little bit. King David was an amazing example of what it means to fight through fear. We're going to go to Psalms 56, verse 3. But I want you to understand what David was going through in this moment. Understand, David, when he wrote this, David had come off of a high a little bit. David had experienced some wins in his life and some great accomplishments. Man, they made a song about David. Saul killed his thousands, David his 10,000s. See, David was a man that had accomplished some things in life. See, some of us, God has empowered us and we've accomplished some things in life, not because of you, but because of the God in you. See, you've accomplished some things in life. You've had some successes. You've seen some good in your life. You've seen some positive in your life. Some of you have seen more positive than what you ever thought simply because of where you came from. Understand, David came from the backside of a mountain. His daddy didn't even want him involved in their life. He was on the backside of a mountain cleaning up sheep and taking care of sheep. And God brought him out to the forefront and empowered him to have some success. But then after that, after he had the success, the same king he saved, which was King Saul, now is the same king that's trying to kill him. King Saul is trying to kill David. And David is running. But now David is running to a place called Gath, which is where the Philistines are. And David just killed their best soldier. He just killed Goliath. So he's running from one enemy into the hands of another enemy, and he doesn't know what to do. He's scared for his life. Is there anybody that feels like you're running from one thing and you're running into the hands of another thing? David finds himself in a place to where he's scared. And verse 3 says this: when I'm afraid. Woo! He said, when I'm afraid. He didn't say if. He didn't say sometimes. David spoke some truth. David said, when I'm afraid. But wait a minute, Pastor. David was a man after God's own heart. He surely was. David said, when I'm afraid, he understood the frailty of humankind, of human nature. He understood who he was. He understood that there's no way that he could do this on his own. Listen to me, you and our nation is in a place. Let me tell you. If I told you I wasn't scared, I'd be lying to you. We find ourselves in a place to where every time we turn around, there's a reason for you and I to be fearful. If we were trusting in man, there's plenty of reason for us to be fearful. There are situations you're going to face in life that will cause you to be fearful. What if I lose my job? What if I lose my career? What if my business shuts down? What if God takes a loved one from me? What if he takes another loved one from me? What if he takes another loved one from me? What if my teenager tries drugs? What if they get addicted? What if I get a medical diagnosis I wasn't expecting? What if I can't feed my family next month? See, you and I, there are plenty of things out there for us to be fearful about. But it helps us realize how frail we are. See, every day I get older, I know that my body is failing me. Every day, I'm only 45, but I get up slower today than I did yesterday. You and I face decisions every day. I see fear on people's face. I see it when y'all come into the sanctuary. I see it when I go to the gas station. People's fear is on their face because they're having to make life decisions at the gas pump. There was a time you could take a $20 bill to the gas station and leave with change. Leave with change, leave with a soda, leave with a bag of chips, leave with something. You talk to everybody at the pump. You got the little thing cleaned off your windows. You turned on the gas pump, you just let it run. Not now. So you at the gas pump counting pennies. Ooh, Lord, if I go past this, I ain't gonna be able to eat lunch today. We are making life decisions. If I get gas today, I can't eat tomorrow. If I go to the grocery store, I see people fearing the grocery store. When they get up to the line and the counter, they're like, oh, Lord. Because everything is twice as much as it was last year. How am I going to do this, Lord? How am I going to make this happen? When I'm afraid, David was afraid. You and I find ourselves in situations where we're afraid. But the one thing we should be encouraged about is this. See, even all of the successes David had, he found himself in a place where he was afraid. See, you and I, no matter where we find ourselves, no matter what successes we've had, no matter what failures we've had, see, David was simply recognizing his need for God. David may have been a man after God's own heart, but he was still a man. And having fear is not a bad thing. But you can't stay there. See, that's what David did. He said, when I'm afraid, he acknowledged that he was afraid. But then he said, I put my trust in you. He said, I acknowledge that I'm afraid. He said, but I know I can't stay here. God has been too good to me for me to be able to stay here. God has proven himself too much in my life for me to stay here. David said, you helped me when I fought the lion and the bear, and when I fought Goliath, and when I fought this. He said, I cannot stay here. King Saul may be coming after me, but I know that you are bigger than he is. And I can't stay here. You might be fearful right now, but you can't stay there. See, David was acknowledging that he was helpless without God. See, he had an opportunity. He could have, when he was afraid, he could have took off and he could have ran. But he said, instead of running, instead of taking my ball and going home, instead of leaving, he said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put my trust in the Lord. He understood he was helpless without God. Do you understand that you are helpless without God? Do you understand that you are helpless without God? That you can't do anything without God empowering you to do so? If he chose not to breathe life into you this morning, you wouldn't be here. That's how dependent you are on God, is that you have to wait for him to breathe breath into you every single second of every single day. The only reason you're breathing is because God is allowing you to breathe. You are helpless without God. It reminds me of a little baby. It reminds me of Chloe. She's less than 6 months. But when she sees her mama, woo! See, when she sees her mama, she knows the characteristics of her mama. She knows the voice of her mama. She knows what her mama looks like. She knows what she sounds like. She knows how her mama smells. She knows that in the short period of time she's been here, that whenever she needed something, her mama has shown up on the scene. Woo! She figured that out, and she's not even 6 months yet. You and I, some of us have been serving God for years, and he has shown up on the scene every time we needed him. We know what he looks like. We know what he smells like. We know what he sounds like. He's proven himself to us over and over and over and over again, and yet we still don't trust him. When we get afraid, we run. We need to learn from a baby. And when she gets a little bit older and she starts walking, she's going to come to mama like this. She's going to be doing this. See, God is looking for some people. God is looking for some people that are willing to trust him enough that when you get scared, you say, Daddy, pick me up. Daddy, I need you. Daddy, I need your help. I'm helpless without you. I can't do this without you. I need your assistance. I need your presence. I need you to be here with me. I know you've proven yourself time and time again, and I trust you to prove yourself again today. You're never too big to put your hands out and say, I need you. I'm 45, and I have to do this every day because I can't do this on my own. There's no way I can do this on my own. I'm not smart enough without God. I'm not knowledgeable enough without God. I don't have enough wisdom without God. I'm not equipped without God. If I don't have the presence of the living God leading and guiding me every second of every single day, I can't do this. I'm helpless without him. See, some of us hadn't realized yet that we're helpless without him. You know why it's so hard to trust God? Because we're still trying to do it on our own. You know what not trusting God means? It means that you have the audacity to say, God, I know better for my life than you do. That's what you're saying to God. You might not verbally say it, but your actions are saying it. See, when you try to go fix it yourself, and Lord knows we have tried. We have tried over and over and over and over again to fix it ourselves. And for some reason, every time we do, we fall on our face and we still think we can fix it ourselves. When are we going to learn that we can't do this on our own? At some point, we got to get past the pride and the arrogance and say, God, I need your help. That's the hardest thing for us to do, is ask for help. But you can't do this by yourself. How many of you have tried? You got t-shirts, you got bruises, you got body aches, you got body pains of you trying to do this on your own. And then you say, well, I ain't going to the church. I don't trust them. It's a bunch of hypocrites in the church. It's hypocrites in HEB, but you still go. Why? Because you got to eat. Guess what? You got to eat spiritually too. It's hypocrites in the club. It don't stop you from going to the club. If we didn't go anywhere where there weren't hypocrites, we'd have to stay in our house all day long. And some of you couldn't do that because you're a hypocrite. If you want to stay away from hypocrites, you got to stay away from yourself. Hallelujah. Stop making excuses. We make excuses with everything else in life. We are willing to bend the knee and surrender. But with God, we always got an excuse as to why we can't. And then when our world falls apart after we made a mess of it, then we come running to the very place that we were trying to avoid. Pastor here, fix this. Wait a minute. Were you not listening to the message? Was I just getting up there talking just to talk? When I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. You understand that the enemy would love nothing more than for you to be scared of everything that you see and hear. See, because most of the time when we get scared, we run and we isolate. See what David was doing in this scripture? You know where David found himself? He was running from one enemy to the next, and he found himself hiding in a cave. He found himself hiding in a cave. See, that's what the enemy wants for you. He wants you to become a prisoner. See, that's what fear wants to do. Fear wants to make you a prisoner in your own life. But God didn't come to make you a prisoner. The Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And the last time I checked, the Bible says that you have the Spirit of the living God dwelling on the inside of you. So where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Jesus said, I came so that you could have life and life more abundantly. God didn't create you to be a prisoner. God created you to have life. And the only way for you and I to have the full life and the life in abundance that God has called us to have is if when we're afraid that we put our trust in you. Now, somebody might be saying this. How is it that I can put my trust in the Lord? James 1, verse 22 says this. It says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. See, we got a lot of people who are hearing what the word says, and we don't have enough people that are doing what it says. You want to trust in, you want to know how to trust in God? The way you trust in God is this, is you take this word, and stop just hearing it and do something with it. If we will begin to apply what we hear to our life, that's evidence of us trusting in God. This is application for you today. See, don't just take this scripture that you heard today and just hear it. See, now God is giving you a responsibility to do something with it. Now you've got to live it out. That's how you show trust. That's how you put your trust in the Lord, is by living out what he says. You may only know one scripture. Guess what? Live that thing out. You don't have to know the entire Bible. Take one scripture that you know and live it out every day. And as you live it out every day, God will give you another scripture. And you live it out every day. And then he'll give you another one. And you live it out every day. You want to know how to trust God? That's how. You take what he says and you apply it to your life. Application. Application is the ingredients. Information plus application equals transformation. Information, you got to know it. That's part of it. That's part of the equation. That's part of the formula. Information is, but you've got to apply it. Information plus application equals transformation. You want to see transformation happen in your life? Guess what? Start applying that knowledge that you know. That's the most simplistic way I can tell you how to trust God. You take his word and you apply it. That's how I begin to trust my wife. That's how I begin to trust my mom. That's how I begin to trust anybody. I take them at their word and I apply it. If they say they're going to do something, then I take what they say and I apply it. And I'm going to trust that they're going to do what they said they're going to do. And when they do, guess what? Next time it makes it a little bit easier for me to trust them. And then when they do it that time, next time it makes it a little bit easier for me to trust them. There's this idea in the Christian community that fear and faith can't reside in the same place. David just told us that it can. David just said, when I'm afraid, I put my faith in God. When I'm afraid, see, that's when my faith kicks up at its best. That's when it's working its most, is when I'm afraid. So when I'm afraid, I put my trust in the Lord. Everybody bow your heads. Father, this day I thank you. I thank you for your word. And I thank you for loving us enough. I thank you for loving us enough to speak truth to us. Lord, I know there are people in this sanctuary. I know there are people watching on live stream. I know there are people within the sound of my voice that are experiencing situations in their life that they've never experienced before. They are experiencing fearful situations that they've never experienced before. But today you told us, don't run, that we should stand and that we should put our trust in you. And the way that we do that is by not just being a hearer of your word, but by being a doer of your word. So Father, I pray that everybody that hears this message would take it to heart and to apply your word. And that they would not just be hearers, but that they would be doers of your word. Lord, all I know is that you require obedience from us. And once you get our obedience, the results are up to you. So, Lord, today I trust you with the results. I trust you with the results in my life. I trust you with the results in your people's life. I trust you with the results of the body of Christ. I trust you with the results of young people. I trust you with the results of our community, of our city, of our state, of our nation, of this world. I trust you with the results. Lord, all I'm going to do is be obedient, even when it hurts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.